Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, good morning. Welcome everyone to Williams. Quickly, if you haven't done so, find the person to your left and to your right and give them a big smile. Go. You better smile at me. All right. Hopefully you have your bulletins in your hand and opened and ready to go. If you're visiting this morning, do something quickly for me. Look to the end of your pew, and there should be a little slim sheet of paper with a couple of questions. We would love for you to fill that out, put it in the offering plate, the golden plate, so we can have a record of your visit. Scotty needs to make an announcement that's not in the bulletin, so come on up here, Scott.
Good morning, friends and neighbors. Just a few quick announcements. First of all, I want to thank everybody for signing up for snacks. We are full through February, and that is awesome. Thank you guys for getting on that for us. We greatly appreciate you. Speaking of snack, we'll meet here tonight at 5:45, and we'll head to Jim and Peggy Green's house. Thank you, Jim and Peggy, for having us tonight. We greatly appreciate you. Another quick announcement. On September 8th, our church has been charged with feeding the Pleasant Valley football team for their away games. And on the 8th, we are going to do a church-wide potluck meal. So I would encourage you, if you would, please sign up. There's really no sign up yet. They'll be there next week. So if you'll please prayerfully consider preparing a dish for that, we would be greatly appreciated. And that would be September the 8th at 5:30 is when we're going to do that meal for them. Thank you very much.
Hey, can I see that? Thanks. All right. This Wednesday, if you see in the bulletin there, we have supper at 5:30. The menu is listed, so if you want to be a part of that, make sure that you call Peggy and get your name on the list. Just $5 a plate. And then at 6:30, we will have our usual meetings. Bible study for the adults, children, and youth. There's a lot of things going on next Sunday. Next Sunday, after the church service, there will be a Sunday school teacher luncheon. So kind of like what we did a couple of months ago, we're going to do that again and just meet up and talk about the upcoming Sunday school curriculum. And then I need to meet with the children's ministry committee right after the service that morning as well, next Sunday, just a quick meeting. And you also see that there's an insert in your bulletin. This Sunday and next Sunday is deacon nomination time, so get that filled out. But make sure that whoever you list, that you have asked, that you have permission to do that first. And don't forget that this Friday is Food Pantry Friday. So volunteers, just remember that this Friday. And then this is something that Scotty was trying to take away from me, but there are plenty of copies for Scotty and you to take home with you today. They're everywhere. If you are wondering how to help with the Louisiana flood victims, there's some items that can be donated at certain places here in Jacksonville and Anniston. There's a detailed list of things to get, what not to get. So take one of these home and get your stuff turned in by this Wednesday, the 24th, okay? But remember to grab one of these as you leave today. Alrighty, I've done enough talking. So now make sure that you read on some other things that I didn't mention but are important for you to know about. So it's time for some Williams loving, and I see someone in particular, Garrett. He is back home. He's been busy, just a little busy, a little, this summer. So find someone that you want to love on this morning and give them a big old hug, kiss on the cheek, shake their hand. I'm coming, Garrett. Go for it.
Thank you.
Good morning. I've noticed, and maybe you have, there's some other folks in the choir, so I'm wondering either how much you paid them, or how much do y'all owe him? And so, no, it's good. It's good to see that folks are invested in getting excited about our choir, and it's good to see you here this morning as we have gathered together on this the Lord's Day for worship. And as we've come together, let us begin our time with a word of prayer. Eternal God, as we have come into this room this morning with glad hearts, knowing that you have joined us, God, after a week when we have seen such devastation, images, Lord, that can cause so many to be hopeless, we come, Lord, knowing that you are here to give us hope, that as we gather to worship, God, that what we gather for is to be reminded of your grace, of your goodness, and of your love. So as we are here, remind us of those things. Make them real to us by the presence of your Holy Spirit, speaking to us through the words we sing, through the words we hear, the words that you speak to us, even in the quietness of our own hearts. Be with us this morning as we worship, God, showing us what you have for us, calling us, and giving us the strength, Lord, to be faithful and obedient unto that call. Be with us, we pray, in Christ's name. Amen.
Good morning. Good morning. Y'all bear with me. I haven't had a chance to practice this. Today's call to worship is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 58. I'm going to begin with verse 9. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help, and he will say, "Here I am." If you remove the yoke from among you, the pointing of the finger, the speaking of evil, if you offer your food to the hungry and satisfy the needs of the afflicted, then your light shall rise in the darkness, and your gloom be like noonday. The Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your needs in parched places, and make your bones strong, and you shall be like a watered garden, like a spring of water, whose waters never fail. Your ancient ruins shall be rebuilt. You shall rise up from the foundations of many generations. You shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of street to live on. If you refrain from trampling the Sabbath, from pursuing your own interest in the holy day, if you call the Sabbath a delight, and the holy day of the Lord honorable, if you honor it, not going on your own ways, serving your own interests, or pursuing your own affairs, then you shall take delight in the Lord, and I will make you ride upon the heights of the earth. I will feed you with the heritage of your ancestor Jacob, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken.
Praise the Lord. Let's all stand as we continue the worship. It's hymn number 10. Oh, worship the King. He is all glorious above. Let's sing it, all right.
Oh, worship the King, all glorious above, and gratefully sing his wonderful love. Our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, a brilliant splendor, and heard it with praise.
Sing it on the second.
Oh, tell of his might, oh, sing of his grace, whose robe is the light, whose hand of his face, his chariots of wrath, the deep thunder clouds form, and dark is his lamp on the wings of the storm.
Everyone sing it out on the last.
Frail children of dust and feeble as frail, in thee do we trust, nor find thee to fail. Thy mercies, how tender, how firm to the end, our Maker, Defender, Redeemer, and Friend.
be seated. Children, make your way up.
How are you guys doing?
Good.
Is everybody enjoying school?
Yes.
Is everybody? Are you enjoying school? So I have a question. How many of you guys have, like a collection of things? I know you have.
I have a collection of shells.
Oh, me awesome.
Too.
Did you guys
have
the beach?
I have a collection of shells, too.
You have shells? Did you guys get those
shells,
at the
rocks,
beach?
Yes.
I got mine.
Awesome.
I've got shells, rocks, and all sorts of things. In
that's true. We had to sort those out the other day. So, like Abby said, one of the things she has... she has a collection of rocks, and so I thought I'd bring some of them here, and she gave me permission.
Hey, I didn't give you permission to get more than one, though.
Oh, well, you can tell. Okay. So, you want to see them? So these are some of the rocks she has. Are they cool? See them? So what I like about rocks is that they're all sorts of different rocks, right? And they have all sorts of colors and textures. You want to pass it around so everybody can see them? Can you pass it?
And send it to me because I already know what
Abby doesn't need them because she knows what they all are. But they're really cool, right? Because there can be all kinds of rocks, all sorts of colors, and some of them have spots, and some of them people pay a lot of money for.
I like that one. That's my favorite.
That's your favorite one? That's a very cool one, isn't it? And also, they're kind of like people because they're formed in all sorts of different ways, right? Like some of them, if you go to the river, they're all smooth because the waters run over them. Some of them are formed like deep in the earth where pressure and stuff gets to them. And they all have different ways of forming. So then I thought about this one. I borrowed this one from a friend of mine. And how would you describe this rock? Very bumpy.
Is
the
know.
Texture? I know you already know.
Already
but the texture's
know.
Kind of rough, right? Would you call it a pretty rock? Maybe. So what I like about these is these are geodes. So when you look at the inside, they're all shiny and sparkly, right? And I know you need to get your geode back. But they're all shiny and sparkly and pretty, right? But you would never be able to guess that from looking outside here, right? Until you crack it open, and then you can see what it's like. Now, I was thinking about this the other day. Who would know what that rock would look like on the inside, even if it hadn't been cracked open? Who would know?
Jesus.
God would know, right? He would know what the rock looks like on the inside. And just like these rocks are like people because they're pretty informed in different ways. This one is also like people. Because no matter what we look like on the outside, no matter what we act like, even the mean people, I know we don't know any mean people, but even the mean people, even people we think of as bad, God knows that on the inside that they're beautiful. And that's something that he asked us to remember, right? That no matter what people are like, and no matter what we think about them, that really they're truly beautiful because they're one of God's creations. And that's something I want you guys to remember as we go through, that you are beautiful and God knows it, and God loves you because of it, as just as he loves everyone on the earth because they are his creation, and he made them. And because he made them, he loves them. All right? Let's go. Okay, I need the rocks back so I don't get in trouble with Abby. There we go. All right. And let's go to Children's Church and see what trouble we can get into up there. Okay?
Praise the Lord. Let's continue the worship. You can just remain seated, but turn with us to hymn number 43, one of my favorites. It says, "Great is thy faithfulness." Everybody sing it.
Great is thy faithfulness. Oh,
verse is my favorite.
Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold goodness, true thy great faithfulness, mercy and love. Sing it.
Praise the Lord. Let's all stand as we sing that last verse.
Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings, O God, with 10,000.
Sing this with me.
Jesus, we just want to thank you. Jesus, we just want to thank you. Jesus, we just want to thank you.
Thank you. Sing it from your heart.
Jesus, we just want to thank you. Jesus, we just want to thank you. Jesus, we just want to thank you.
Thank you for being.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we're so thankful for this day that you've given us. Lord, the breath of life and being able to gather together with friends and family within your house. Lord, we thank you for the many blessings that you've given to us individually and within this church. We just ask that we prayerfully consider what you would have us to do to give back to you. Lord, we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ. We ask all these things in your name. Amen.
Thank you. We sing.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
The Lord be with you. And if he's not with you after that, I don't know what it'll take, because my goodness. I saw Pat get a little Roy in there clapping for a minute. Well, now.
I taught him that.
I thought you may have. Well, we're listening this morning to the 13th chapter of Luke's Gospel. Luke chapter 10, I'm sorry, 13, beginning with verse 10. Reading through to verse 17 is where we'll be this morning. Luke chapter 13, beginning with verse 10, says, "Now he was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath, and just then there appeared a woman with a spirit that had crippled her for 18 years. She was bent over and was quite unable to stand up straight. When Jesus saw her, he called her over and said, 'Woman, you are set free from your ailment.' When he laid his hands on her, immediately she stood up straight and began praising God. But the leader of the synagogue, indignant because Jesus had cured on the Sabbath, kept saying to the crowd, 'There are 6 days on which work ought to be done. Come on those days and be cured, and not on the Sabbath day.' But the Lord answered him and said, 'You hypocrites, does not each of you on the Sabbath untie his ox or his donkey from the manger and lead it away to give it water? And ought not this woman, a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan bound for 18 long years, be set free from this bondage on the Sabbath day?' When he said this, all his opponents were put to shame, and the entire crowd was rejoicing at all the wonderful things that he was doing." May God bless the reading and hearing of Holy Scripture. Would you pray with me? Great God, our rock and our redeemer, we pray, Lord, now that you give us ears to hear your words and not mine. You give us open hearts, Lord, to receive what you have for us. Open hands, Lord, that we may give what you give to us freely to all of those to whom you call us. And Lord, that in this time that we hear you speak to us from Holy Scripture. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. 18 years. That's a long time to do anything. It's a long time to drive a car. It's a long time to keep a pair of pants, especially if you're going to wear them every day. I probably have a few that are that old, but I don't wear them every day. It's a long time to keep things like a lawnmower or a weed eater. It's a long time to do the same job. A lot of people work for a lot longer with the same company, but to do the same job for 18 years, that's a long time. 18 years is a long time to do anything, but it can especially feel like a long time to wait. I can remember when I was a kid being told that once you turn 18, you get to be an adult. That's a lie, by the way, for most of us anyway. I was told I'd be free to move out of the house, right? It was an option. You can leave the house at 18 if you want to get out of the house. That's what that meant. You could get a job, although you could get one at 15, too. You could join the military. You could vote. You could get a loan. You could do all kinds of grown-up things when you turn 18. But even when I was 12, though, 18 seemed like centuries away. I can imagine 18 years is a long time to wait, because I'm sure the 16 years between 1983, when Return of the Jedi came out, and 1999, when Phantom Menace was released, felt like thousands of years to Star Wars fans. And you better believe 18 years sounds like a life sentence when the judge's gavel falls. 18 years in the state penitentiary. I bet 18 years feels like forever. 18 years is a long time. A long time when it's measured in hash marks, scratched on the cinder block wall. 18 years is a long time to have to do anything. It's a long time to have to wait. And it's a long, long time to be stooped over, unable to even stand up straight. That's how long Luke tells us this nameless woman in our text this morning had suffered with this crippling spirit. For 18 years, she learned people not by the color of their eyes, not by the look on their face, but by the sight of their feet. For 18 years, she recognized where she was going, not by landmarks or street signs, but by the cracks in the ground and the way the path was worn smooth. For 18 years, she'd been racked with pain, unable to stand, unable to hug her loved ones, unable to look another person eye to eye. For 18 years, she was stooped over. Children would have grown up and had their own children in that time. Friends would have died. People would have moved in and out of her life. For 18 years, she suffered through that pain. And to you and I, that already sounds like a long time, but in a day when life expectancy was much shorter, that's half of her life gone, spent, stooped over in pain, unable to stand. 18 years is a long time to wait for a healing rabbi to show up at your synagogue. But that's how long it took before Jesus showed up one day to teach in her local synagogue on the Sabbath. You know, I almost wonder if there was a sign out front, sort of like ours, and on it it said, "This Sabbath, special guest rabbi, Jesus of Nazareth, bring a friend." I wonder if it said that. I wonder if it had made the rounds in the gossip circles. You know, I heard Jesus is going to be at the synagogue this Sabbath. Well, that's good. I don't know if I can stomach another one of Rabbi Chris's sermons. I wonder if Jesus just showed up that Sabbath and was asked to teach. You know, that's how it is in some small little rural congregations. Guest preacher shows up, just there to worship, sits in the back. Pastor says, "Oh, I see brother so-and-so is here. Won't you come up and give us a sermon?" Maybe it's because the pastor's unprepared. Maybe he'd like to show folks how bad it can be. "You don't think I'm a bad preacher? Wait till you hear this guy." I don't know. I'm never really sure. But maybe that's what it was that day. Maybe the rabbi of that synagogue saw Jesus in the back, gathered with his disciples, and during the announcements about everything going on in the synagogue that week, he said, "Oh, hey, Jesus is here. Won't you come up and give us the lesson this morning?" I'm not really sure how it came to be. Maybe he was scheduled, listed in the bulletin. Maybe it was a surprise. But my guess is that it wasn't the woman's first time there. She wasn't a curious passerby, sticking her crippled head in the door to see what was going on. She didn't see the name outside and go, "I wonder what he's like," and stop by. No. It's very likely this woman had been a regular at that synagogue, and she was a regular in the community. In fact, I wouldn't doubt if folks knew her as, "Oh, you know, I don't remember her name, but she's the one always stooped over, one always bent over. Been that way as long as I've known her." That means for at least 18 years, this woman had darkened the door of that synagogue. For 18 years, folks in that place had done business with her, had crossed paths with her in the street, and they had seen her in the marketplace and in other spots in the community. For 18 long years, this woman had lived at least that long in this community and been a part of it. And though I don't doubt that folks kept their distance. After all, in those days, if you were bent over, crippled, if you were sick, it wasn't genetic. It wasn't the hard labor of life. It's because you had sinned. And the devil had flung something on you. And so good religious folks kept their distance from women walking around stooped over. I imagine that Sabbath, this woman took a seat in the back. You know, in those days, women and men, I can't help it, it's the way it was, were kept separate. Women were sort of pushed over to the side, better to be seen barely and never heard, never acknowledged. I imagine she stared at the ground as trying to strain up to listen to what the rabbi would have to say would only cause more cramps, more cricks, more all kinds of pain. And I'm quite sure she was staring there, maybe counting the grains of sand on the ground, seeing where weeds were growing up through the cracks. And it startled her when she heard Jesus call her name, a name unfortunately forgotten by the time Luke hears the story. I do wonder, though, what went through her mind What went through her mind when Jesus calls her over and she says, "Woman, you're set free from your ailment"? I wonder, really. In that brief moment, did she think to herself, "Who's this crazy fool? 18 years I've been over. I don't know him. He doesn't know me. Who does he think he is? He's not going to cure me in a matter of moments." But she doesn't have long to think that way. Jesus, Luke tells us, lays his hands on her. And then Luke says, in words really reminiscent of Mark, immediately she stood up and began praising God. Now that seems simple when you think of other miracles, right? He didn't heal or give her sight back. He didn't raise her from the dead. He just stood her up. Just stood her up. And she began praising God. Now, I don't know about you, but I can hear all the thoughts, all the little side conversations, all the notes being passed around in the synagogue that morning, can't you? Some folks really, they really believed it. "Praise God, that woman done got healed. It's a miracle," they'd say. And then some might go, "You know, I bet it was staged. I don't remember seeing her. I think she's putting on. I really do. I bet she just showed up when Jesus was here. I bet he's going to take up an offering." And then you can hear some of the other ones. "Oh, it's fake. I saw her yesterday down at the Walmarts buying shampoo on the top shelf. And so you know she can stand up straight." I don't know. I imagine there were people who believed, there were people who doubted in that synagogue, just as there are any time the Spirit of God moves among us. But one thing I do know, the religious folks didn't like it one bit. Isn't that funny? The religious folks often don't like when Jesus shows up. It's true then, it's true today. Luke says the leader of the synagogue, indignant because Jesus had cured on the Sabbath, kept saying to the crowd, "There are 6 days on which work ought to be done. Come back on those days and be cured, and not on the Sabbath." What an odd thing to say. I mean, really, listen to how he addresses them. 6 days on which work ought to be done. Who's he talking to? Jesus, the one who did the work? "Come back on those days and be cured." The woman? The crowd? Were they lining up after she stood up straight? "Oh, Jesus, I've been down on my back for a while now. Oh, Jesus, I got the arthritis in my hands. Jesus, I need this, I need this, I need this." Did they start lining up? "Don't fool with this today. Come back. There's 6 other days to be healed. Don't you fool with this on the Sabbath." Who's he indignant towards? Who's he mad at? Sounds to me like he's mad at the crowd, mad at the woman, mad at Jesus. Sounds to me like he's mad at everybody. But why? Because he says healing took place on the Sabbath. There are obviously 6 other days to do all this. He in effect says, "Come back when we're not having church. Come back when we're not having church if you want to be cured. Don't bother us with your needing to be freed from a spirit of liberation. Don't come back bothering us, wanting to be freed from oppression on this holy day when we gather to remember how we were freed from oppression. Come back when we're allowed to heal you, when our religion doesn't prevent us from making you whole again." I can't help but think that there were even those, one or two of them had a thought, something like, "She's been bent over for 18 years and she wants to do it today. She's had problems her whole life and she wants to come today to church. She couldn't do this quietly on the side when nobody was looking. Why is the leader of the synagogue so ill? What's really causing him to be indignant?" Perhaps, maybe I'd like to give him the benefit of the doubt. Maybe he was genuinely upset that Sabbath laws had been broken. I mean, I can understand that. Really, I can. Rules are rules for a reason, you know, especially religious rules. I mean, the Bible says we have to keep the Sabbath. We have to remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. I mean, God rested from his work on the Sabbath. Shouldn't we also rest? As a minister, I'm often shocked, not really shocked, by the contradictory nature of such a sentiment from some church folks who want to have all sorts of services, meetings, practices, events on Sunday. On the one hand, they claim Sunday is the Christian Sabbath, a day of rest and worship, but on the other, they jam it so full of stuff that by the time it's over, they're worn out and exhausted, and they've got no Sabbath rest, none whatsoever. It was in the same way, I think, the same thing folks had done for the Sabbath in Jesus' day. There was the work of non-work. the tediousness of being sure not to do anything that might be considered work on the Sabbath, lest one incur the wrath of a resting God. A person had to keep track of their steps on the Sabbath, being sure not to exceed the minimum number required for work. One had to be mindful of what chores were done, how much food they consumed, how much weight they carried, how many words they said, and on these Shabbat, these Sabbath laws went. It became work just to make sure you weren't working. And so I can understand if the leader of the synagogues was indignant because he felt that the Sabbath was being broken. Just as I can understand when church folks get bent out of shape, when Sunday school is called off or service is canceled. Doesn't mean any of them are right, but I can understand it. Or maybe the leader of the synagogue was just offended. Offended that this woman had been bent by this spirit for 18 years and is only now being healed by this visiting rabbi. I can understand that. Being offended when the work you feel called to do is done by somebody else on your turf. And somebody else comes in to do God's work there, you're called to do it. She'd been crippled for 18 years. Why didn't she come visit him in the office? Why not stop him in the streets? Rabbi, I've been bent over for 18 years. Can you do something about it? Can you pray for me? Why didn't she believe that he could heal her? If she was a woman of faith, she would have known, you don't do this kind of thing on the Sabbath. When Jesus called her name, she would have said, no, I'll talk to the rabbi after service. Maybe the leader of the synagogue was just offended, hurt that he didn't get to do the one thing God had called him to do, hurt that he didn't get to be the one to bring healing to a member of his community, but instead he had to be a spectator while somebody else did it by a visiting rabbi on the Sabbath. It was Jesus. Maybe. But I think there's something more to his indignation, something more to why he's angry. To tell the truth, I think it's at the heart of why many of us get angry when God moves through someone else. I think he was jealous. Really. After all, that's what happens when our comfortable faith gives way to the unpredictable work of God's Spirit. When we're so convinced that our way is the right way and everybody ought to do things our way, when we think we've got the key, we've got the answer, we're the only ones who know the right things to do, Jesus jumps in and breaks it all up. Christ busts up our comfortable religion that helps to keep us in control, that allows us to be the definers of Sabbath, the writers of rules. No healing on the Sabbath? Why? Jesus says, you hypocrites. Do not each of you on the Sabbath untie your ox, your donkey, lead them away from the manger to water, let them have a drink? Are you saying, Jesus says, that livestock, oxen, donkey, are more valuable than this woman, your sister? Do you really believe, Jesus says, that God cares more about your stock getting a drink of water on Saturday than this woman being made whole? I have to tell you something. I'm a little afraid to hear what our real answers might be. We may think it's an obvious decision. Of course, we should heal a woman on the Sabbath if we're going to water our livestock. But what if the question were posed to us more in our context, to the church today? What if it were posed a little differently? You turn on the TV, that Sarah McLachlan song plays, the little bug-eyed shaky chihuahua there on the screen. And you can't hold it back. Your eyes water. You can't find the remote to turn it. I'll send them some money. That dog needs to eat. I'll send them some money. It's a good thing. But would you send money to a starving child? Even if he was Muslim? If his parents were Muslim? If you take time out of your day to play with your own children, would you take time to play with the children who have no parents? What if they were disabled? Couldn't really play back. Just sat in a wheelchair and screamed. Screamed the whole time out of frustration. Would you do that? If you'd gladly give to CBF for disaster relief, would you give to a secular nonprofit that's actively helping to bring clean water to villages around the world that don't have it? That's a different way to think of it. You see, friends, I found that we're not too unlike the leader of the synagogue in the story Luke's telling us. We've grown protective of our religion to the point of missing the forest for the trees. We've grown too concerned about man-made religious rules, regulations, practices, policies and procedures, limits, laws, outlines, bylaws, all those things. We've gotten too caught up in setting up the boundaries of who's in and who's out to realize we're called to love all people, not just the ones we've drawn our circles around. We've allowed too much religion to get in the way of what Jesus actually calls us to do. So we argue about what church is supposed to look like, about how many church services we should have. We argue about when we're supposed to do this and what we're supposed to do, what we should wear to church, what we shouldn't wear to church, what Bible we should read. We argue about all these things. And we've mixed politics in with our religion so much that many people can't tell them apart. And worst of all, they can't tell they're missing the point altogether. We've decided that love can be defined as threats of damnation and self-righteousness, that compassion is a sign of weakness, and that hospitality is reserved only for those who've been extremely vetted. And I am becoming more and more convinced that so many Christians behave this way because we are jealous. Jealous that others we view as less worthy, less honorable, less deserving, more reckless, more careless, more wicked, more sinful, dirtier, poorer, lower than us are loved by that same unconditional love that comes from Christ, the same love with which we are loved. And to be honest with you, sometimes it drives me crazy to think about it, to think that God would love some folks as much as he loves me. And that's what's really so controversial about the cross, about the gospel, about what Jesus did in the synagogue that day. Not that it keeps out the folks who ought to be kept out, but that the love of God always draws the circle wider. That's what makes the synagogue leader indignant. The woman with the crippling spirit, she's made whole. That's what made the other religious leaders of Jesus' day angry. The prostitutes, Jesus says, they're in. The tax collectors, Jesus says, they're in. The Gentiles, them, Jesus says, they're in. The cursed, the downtrodden, the Sabbath breakers, the meek, the poor, the lazy, the blind, the sorry, the old, the young, the women, the children, all of them, all of them. And every single time, you know what Jesus says? Yep, they're in, all of them. I can't help but ask, then where does it stop, Jesus? Where do we get to draw the line? When does all of this grace, when does all of this love, when does all of this joy end? When? Give me a time. When can I finally sit down and say, it's done? When can I finally say, today is the end of me loving some people? And you know what? You know what I hear Jesus telling me every single time? Every time I ask him, when I ask him, when does it end? When do I get to say I've loved enough? Do you know what he tells me? Any day but today. And he tells me that every single day. Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on us. Lord, when like the leader of the synagogue, we miss your work for the religion we have created. Help us, God, to be sensitive to the moving of your Holy Spirit, to know, Lord, that you call us to bring your kingdom on earth as it is in heaven, a kingdom of love, a kingdom of joy, kingdom that welcomes the sinner to grace and to love. For Lord, you have welcomed us, and do not let us take your love for granted and hoard it to ourselves. God, help us to see those who are bent all around us, those who quietly suffer, those who continue for so long. And help us, Lord, to serve them, to love them, to help them to stand up straight so that they may see you in us. Lord Jesus, be with us now, we pray in your holy name. Amen.
Hymn number 330, let's all stand as we sing.
We have reason to rejoice as we do every Sunday, but even more so now. Sarah's come this morning to confess her desire to follow Jesus as Lord and to follow him through the waters of baptism. So all of God's people who rejoice with her say amen.
Amen.
As I like to say, the rest of you can go home with the devil. And so it is so good. I'm going to ask you guys to hang out up here. Y'all come by and express your joy and your thanksgiving and great gratefulness to this family, what they mean to this church and this new life in Christ. And as you go out from this place, may you remember the words we've heard today. May you look all around you for the ways that Christ is calling you to serve those around you and drawing the circle ever wider. Let us pray together. Lord Jesus, we ask you go with us from this place. God, guide our every step. Help us to have your eyes to see the work you call us to all around us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.